fabulously fired from her job.
You know plenty.
I checked my messages. Shall I continue?
Oh, yeah.
All right, well, Niche Kitty is probably, definitely losing her virginity and perhaps getting pregnant simultaneously, this very as we speak in. Kind of like, well, like...
Kind of like her mom.
Kind of like her mom. And that is pretty much it for her glamorous life.
No, because the boss thing.
Oh, my God, that's right. She was also making out sliding lips with her 60-year-old boss. Why did you do that?
Just because.
Nobody tells me anything around here.
Yeah, but by the end of Home for the Holidays, they'll tell Charles Durning more than he really wants to know. With daughter Holly Hunter, her obnoxious kid brother Robert Downey Jr., brother-in-law Steve Guttenberg, and the rest of this colorfully dysfunctional family, all enjoying a Thanksgiving dinner as served up to them by director Jodie Foster. Now, this bittersweet comedy is just one of the five big new titles that we'll review on this edition of Sneak Previews. I'm Michael Medved.
And I'm Jeffrey Lyons, and we'll go Home for the Holidays in just a moment. First, we turn to Gold Diggers, The Secret of Bear Mountain. This is a teenage adventure starring Christina Ricci. You know her from those Addams Family movies, and Anna Chlumsky of the My Girl films. Ricci's moved to Oregon with her mother and soon befriends Chlumsky, whose free-spirited ways make her an outcast among other girls, but whose adventurous personality leads the new friends on a search for a local legend.
There really is a fortress of gold. And what if it's waiting for us? Right there inside Bear Mountain.
Now it's finally here. June 21st.
But isn't that mountain full of caves and mines?
Yep, and one of them is going to lead us to the fortress of gold.
Which one? I mean, there must be so many.
In the book, Molly Morgan says that you can find the cave at high noon on the day of the summer solstice. It's the only time when the sun's rays are at the exact right angle to shine inside the cave and bounce back.
11:51. Nine more minutes. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Later, when Chlumsky disappears with her mother's abusive boyfriend, Ricci suspects her friend's been forced to show the way to the treasure. So she enlists the help of the local sheriff, Brian Kerwin.
Let's wait and talk to Lynette.
We can't wait. That's all you ever do is wait. I mean, I know what happened. Ray got drunk and told Jody to take him to the gold. Lynette must have tried to stop him, and he smashed her. Jody is in danger, and you're not doing anything.
I think we should listen to her this time.
Come on, get out of here.
Dad? Where's Dad?
Dad, call the state police. Have them do an aerial surveillance of Bear Mountain and all the surrounding areas. See if there's... if they can spot anything that might suggest that a man and a girl have been there. You know, I can't believe that I'm doing this. I have known that guy my whole life.
Boy, I was terribly disappointed in this picture. When it started out the first 10 minutes, I thought, this is going to be a lot of fun. Here, after all, are two very likable 13-year-old actresses, and we don't have a lot of movies which are sort of adventure stories for girls, and this was sort of a Hardy Boys-style adventure, and it sort of opened up, and it had a kind of energy to it. And then it just turns so dark and disturbing. There's an entirely big subplot where Anna Chlumsky's mother's boyfriend, played by David Keith, is an alcoholic, and he's abusive, and he beats them both up. And the entire thing becomes very disturbing. I would never think of taking my kids to see this, or I can't recommend it to anybody else's kids.
Nor can I. You're absolutely right. And I was hoping, in fact, at that point in the movie, that you were somehow seeing a different version that you would enjoy where I did not. I mean, I have an 8-year-old daughter who's heard about this movie. It's amazing how the word gets around on certain films. She wants to see it. I don't want her to see it precisely for those reasons. Not only that, I like Anna Chlumsky. I've always have. I thought she and Christina Ricci didn't quite hit it off together. Christina Ricci's character whines a little bit too much during the movie.
I think the acting of both of them is terrible in this film.
Didn't you notice the cheesy special effects? That wasn't a mountain there. That was a studio shot.
Well, most of the entire movie takes place in the stupid papier-mâché cave, which looks about as convincing as the cave in Tom Sawyer's Island in Disneyland. And then there's a huge avalanche where a pile of rocks come down onto Christina Ricci's foot, and she can't get out, and she's caught under the water for 4 hours, and then, of course, when she does get out, everything's fine again. There's no injury at all.
The whole movie is narrated by the kind of older version of Christina Ricci's character, and it's told in flashback. At least take that element and add some sort of nostalgia to it, and none of that is there. Instead, we see Diana Scarwood, who plays Klumsky's mother, as the victim of the abuse from her boyfriend. Diana Scarwood always plays the victim.
Right, Look, it has also, I think, one of the worst endings I've seen in any film this year that makes no sense with the rest of the picture. Terrible movie, not recommended. Our next movie, something different. This one is Copycat. It's about two strong professional women joining forces to catch a sadistic serial killer. Holly Hunter plays an ambitious police detective, and Sigourney Weaver is a world-renowned criminal psychologist who at first doesn't want to get involved in the case at all.
Why would he send this to you?
Why do you think?
Nobody's mentioned your involvement.
That's because there is no involvement. I am not involved. This is a game they play. They hang around the scenes watching the cops, feeling superior to them. And instead of catching him there, you led him to me.
He didn't write to me. He wrote to you. Why?
Because I'm their damn pinup girl, that's why. They all know me. They have libraries. They collect clippings. I'm the muse of serial killers.
Since she's already been attacked by one of the vicious killers in that informal fan club, Weaver becomes agoraphobic, refusing to leave her San Francisco apartment. But still, she can use her computer to help solve crimes and to see the resemblance between new killings and classic cases.
How'd you know about that?
There were needle marks on her right arm.
So far, nothing they test for comes up positive.
Is the body found near a no dumping sign?
Yes.
Like this?
I could have taken that picture this morning.
Shit. He switched from DeSalvo to Bianchi and Buono, the hillside strangler. Two men, two kinds of sperm. Very witty, our guy.
Well, but you said that they're like robots. That is not consistent with what you have...
Consistency is the hobgoblin of small minds. Tell them to test for the chemicals found in window cleaner. Ammonia, ethanol. It's what they injected into one of their victims.
Why these guys? And why in such detail?
He wants to dazzle us. I mean, anyone can strangle someone in a bathtub, right? He's just saying, look out. I'm just getting started.
Eventually, in the best Hannibal Lecter tradition, the good guys have to turn to an imprisoned bad guy and masked murderer, well played by Harry Connick Jr., to help them understand the mind of the new killer on the block.
This is Inspector Monahan. I'll be speaking for Dr. Hudson.
I'm hanging up. I ain't talking to no cop. Warden lied to me.
Dr. Hudson just received your book. Do you know anything about it?
Oh, yeah. I surely do, but, that's all I'm saying until that foxy lady gets on the horn. Put her on.
Hello, Mr. Cullum.
Doc. I've been expecting your call. Hey, from one offer to another, how'd you like my book?
What do you know about the man who delivered it?
Peter Curtin. What about him?
Peter Curtin?
Oh, yeah.
Peter Curtin is the name of a serial killer from the 30s in Germany.
I'll be damned. He took that man's name. He bothering you?
He broke into my apartment to leave your book.
Kind of a hand delivery, huh?
Did you put him up to it?
Stop. This Curtin guy, he's been writing me all these letters. I figured he owed me a couple of favors. So I sent a book with him to your house. I didn't think he'd break in, though. Yeah, steer clear of that son of a gun. He's a freak.
Well, he's no bargain either. Boy, Harry Connick Jr., of all people, cast as a serial killer.
Where
he's excellent.
Even sing.
And yes, you're right. How many times have you seen the Hannibal Lecter kind of character where, to move the plot along, they go to an imprisoned serial killer to get advice on how to proceed to find the new killer? Yes, I've seen that before, but I'll tell you, even though there are flaws in this movie, even though I usually hate this type of movie, I walked out of the theater scared. It worked on me. That's all it was trying to do.
And the only thing that scared me was the chutzpah, you'll pardon the expression, of calling a film like this Copycat when it's so obvious that they've just recycled other elements of other movies.
That's why they're calling it Copycat. Yeah, it's kind of an in-joke.
The problem is this comes across to me a little bit like Seven Light. And one of the reasons it's like Seven Light, at least in Seven, when you finally meet the killer, he's scary. Here, when you meet the killer and you see these action scenes that are badly staged at the end, it's absolutely not a force of evil that you can experience or react to or be scared by.
That's what scared me in a different way, because the killer is somebody not
scared
necessarily
by the incompetence?
Well, yeah, not necessarily somebody who is terrifying or has huge eyes, some sort of monster. It is somebody so ordinary.
And,
it is somebody
right.
so who does horrifying things, but it leads us to say it could be anybody around
and,
us.
And that's part of the
killers.
Point that they're trying to make in the picture. But part of the problem I had with it is it's not believable at all. We're asked to believe that this killer can go in and out of Sigourney Weaver's mm-hmm. apartment at will, and they never do anything to stop him. And I felt sorry for Sigourney Weaver in this. She's a fine actress, but there are two different scenes where she's going to the bathroom, and in the middle of going to the bathroom, the killer comes in, puts a noose around her neck, and lifts her up above the
Did
toilet and
you?
Dangles her there.
Or did it just repulse you?
I was embarrassed for Sigourney Weaver. She really should be doing better work than this, and so should John Amiel, who's the director here. He previously directed Summersby, which I liked a lot. He did a wonderful film in England right. called Queen of Hearts.
Let him try
why
something
he's doing...
new. Why you want to limit him? Every director, you know, they say every you comedian know, wants to play something serious. I'm sure a lot of directors want to try horror movies.
We don't need more serial killer shockers.
Easily said,
we
but
don't
if it works
it.
On me, Michael, I've got to admit it. I don't like these kind of pictures generally, but if it works on me, I walked out of there with the hairs on my... on my body standing up.
Okay, put the hairs on your body back down, and we're going to go on to another picture. And this one is called Home for the Holidays, and it's from director Jodie Foster, with Holly Hunter this time playing a struggling single mother who goes home to her parents for Thanksgiving. And even though she doesn't feel that she's got much to be thankful for this year, she's just lost her job at an art museum, and her 15-year-old daughter has decided to spend the holiday with her boyfriend. And now Holly Hunter has to deal with the disapproval of her demanding mother, Anne Bancroft.
I can't believe you're not going to call your daughter tonight to see if she's even still in one piece.
Kit's fine. I promised I wouldn't call her.
All I know is I couldn't sleep without knowing if my own flesh and blood was dead or alive.
But then, Kit's not you and you're not me.
What the hell does that mean, Mommy?
The yin and the yang, that's what it means. It means that Kit's ungrateful, just like all these kids these days. Look at your sister Joanne, the way she's ungrateful.
Mom, Joanne's a saint.
That's for the Pope to decide. Right now, she's a pain in the my feet every 10 minutes. Wait till she comes barging in here tomorrow. Little misorganized with her fabulous Nutri-Bird.
Wait a minute. We're not doing the turkey?
Of course we are. I'm doing my bird. She's doing hers. Don't ask. You're not going to eat that meatloaf, right? Just because it was once a cow?
What's the point of eating raw meat, Mother?
Well, there is no point. I mean, life makes no sense. Look at you. You paint as good as Vincent Van Gogh here. So why isn't some man from Japan giving you $63 million just for one lousy picture?
It's his car. Mm.
Soon, all the other family members begin to assemble for turkey dinner, including Hunter's sister, Cynthia Stevenson, and her brother-in-law, Steve Guttenberg. But they're not quite ready to face the rest of the family, especially the wildly eccentric little brother, Robert Downey Jr.
Brady's leaking. If it ruins my dress, I'll just...
What, you'll sue us?
Doors.
T-Rex!
Mom, tell him to stop!
Hey, let's see if you can
stop this effort. Hey, Mr. Funny Business!
Hey, Joe. How are you?
Where you been? We ate already.
Remember I said during Copycat how the hairs on my body were standing up because
I
was so scared? Well, it happened with this movie, too. For a different reason. I thought it was going to go on forever. That was terrifying to me. What could be more depressing than a Thanksgiving with depressing parents and a dysfunctional family? Every relative is kooky. Everybody around the table has a different kind of sob story. And we're wondering, boy, do I hate the holidays already? My goodness. Enough of this kind of talk.
And I'm so silly. I ended up loving this movie.
Yeah,
I really did.
Again.
I really did. And partially because it does start out that way. And it sets you on edge. And these people are so obnoxious and so difficult. But then Jodie Foster, I think, brilliantly does sort of a switch, almost turns a switch around where you get to care deeply about these people.
I was just going to ask you, do you care about any of these people?
I cared about every one of them.
I thought
this was the best ensemble acting I had seen in any film this year. I mean, every single person in this film is brilliant. Robert Downey Jr. creates a character, this brother, because he's a gay young man,
but
and he
so
comes home and he has
top.
Trouble
it's,
with his parents. And,
it's,
but he,
it's
you,
so
you, end
overdone.
Up, you end up feeling so sympathetic for every single one of them, including, by the way, Claire Danes, a rising star, who's terrific as Holly Hunter's daughter.
If I'm not going to like a movie with Anne Bancroft, whom I revere, mm-hmm. something's going on here that is not working. Now, Geraldine Chaplin shows mm-hmm. up as the kooky aunt, and we want to know something about why she got that way. We don't know. She's given 10 seconds
she's
around
the
table.
She's the kooky spinster
aunt.
Yeah, I mean,
but
look,
I want to know more
I
about
know,
one
I
of these characters.
I know some families rather well where they have kooky spinster
yeah, but
aunts.
They all have a history about them. Get into one person. and make me care. You know, Holly Hunter's character should have done the biggest U-turn at the airport and gone back and even spent the holidays alone rather than around this table, but we're forced to endure it. I just can't understand the appeal here.
At the end of it, people will come out of this picture with a genuine glow that is appropriate for the holidays, even though this is not sort of some kind of soupy, sappy, schmaltzy vision.
Well, I'll have my dinner out next time. But next up is Les Miserables, which, despite the title, has very little to do with the Victor Hugo story, which has been the subject of movies and the long-running Broadway musical. Instead, this movie centers on World War II, and it stars one of the great names in the history of French cinema. Jean-Paul Belmondo, behind the wheel here, plays a former boxer who becomes a truck driver and who decides to help a Jewish family escape to Switzerland during the German occupation of France. But along the way, he insists they read him passages from Les Miserables because he thinks the misfortunes of the novel's protagonist, Jean Valjean, parallel events in his own life. As they approach the border, the parents decide to hide their daughter in a nearby convent school, with Belmondo posing as the little girl's father.
Vous n'avez pas peur qu'elle rentre ici en plein milieu d'année scolaire, hein?
Non. Du moment qu'elle rentre, c'est bien pour elle, je pense.
Et vous aurez la possibilité de voir votre fille souvent?
Ah oui. Pas dès que je pourrai.
Et vous l'avez élevée tout seul jusqu'à maintenant?
Ah oui. Tout seul, comme un garçon. C'est pour ça que je vous reviens maintenant que c'est une petite fille. Hein, Salomé? Oui, tu voudrais bien.
Non, on va en faire une petite fille.
Later, the mother is captured by the Germans and, along with other attractive women, is forced to be an escort for German officers.
En 1937, je donnais un concert à Garou. J'étais très flatté de savoir que la danseuse étoile, Elise Zimmermann, était dans la salle.
Qu'est-ce qu'on fait ici?
La plupart de ces hommes étaient à la semaine dernière sur le front de l'Est. Je leur promis une très belle soirée.
Vous êtes français?
Oui.
Alors pourquoi cet uniforme?
Ah, parce que les Allemands aiment bien honorer les bons Français.
C'est avec vous que je dois passer la nuit?
Ben, si vous voulez survivre à cette guerre, ça me semble plus raisonnable.
Oui. J'aurais préféré que vous soyez allemand.
Moi aussi.
Vous savez très bien de quoi je veux parler.
Toutes les femmes qui sont ici ce soir, mademoiselle, ont été choisies pour de bonnes raisons.
Ça va?
Oui, parfait. Personne n'a voulu de moi.
Il faut absolument que je trouve un téléphone pour appeler ma fille.
Madame Simon, le général vous a fait préparer un petit dîner. Intime. Veuillez me suivre, s'il vous plaît.
Madame Simon, ne faites plus jamais ça. Sinon, je ne vais pas pouvoir vous garder.
Le petit fest!
The mother there is played by Alessandra Martinez, mm-hmm. Who's a real-life ballerina. Very distinguished ballerina in France, playing a ballerina in the film, and she is terrific. Look, the only thing I disliked about this film was the title. I mean, it really has nothing at all to do with Victor Hugo, despite the fact that they keep making reference to the old Victor Hugo novel, but it is in its own right a sprawling, hugely ambitious, often very involving story. It starts out right on New Year's Eve of 1900, and I was actually completely captured at that point because what they show is people looking forward to the 20th century, just as we'll soon be looking forward to the 21st century, and the high hopes that people had, not knowing all of the horrors and the nightmares that both the characters and real-life people would experience in the century.
Just when you think you've seen enough of dysfunctional families, serial killers, abusive parents, along comes a movie like Les Miserables, which, despite its title, you're right, restores your faith in the fact that out there someone, in this case Claude Lelouch, is making great films. This is autobiographical, this is absorbing,
well,
this covers,
to
some extent.
It relates to the fact that he himself, with his parents, was a refugee from the Nazis during World War II.
And while it covers most of the first half of the century, it concentrates on the events around World War II. And I'll tell you, after the first 10 minutes, I cared deeply about every single character on that screen, except the Germans, of course, the Nazis, I should say, but every single event, and I didn't know what was going to happen. I remembered what had happened before. They referred to it. I was involved in it. I felt like I was another character, and that's what the key to making me impressed with the film.
Lelouch, who's best known in this country, of course, for a man and a woman, is sort of known for these sweeping epics that become very emotional and sentimental. That's true here. Not all of it works, but there is consistently brilliant film music by two great composers, Michel Legrand and Francis Lai, which adds to making this movie, I think, effective.
And, you know, we always talk about our kids. I have a 14-year-old. He doesn't see many foreign films, many foreign language films. This may be the first important film I'm going to insist he see. I think this is a film I won't soon forget. Well, next we turn to our family find, speaking of families, and this time we're pleased to recommend a new release on video of a movie that played only briefly in theaters last Christmas, but now it's available for the whole family to enjoy at home. It's Miracle on 34th Street, one of the finest remakes of recent years, with adorable Mara Wilson as the daughter of a single mother and a department store executive. And here, the little girl watches the store's Thanksgiving Day parade with her upstairs neighbor and new friend, Dylan McDermott.
Do you know how much it costs to make this parade?
$1 million. $2 million?
1.6. And it's probably a big mistake because some guy's gonna buy Kohl's and turn it into a junk store.
That's not gonna happen. Two big banks just came in and they rescued Kohl's, so you better check your sources.
But Kohl's has to pay them back plus interest. If they don't sell a lot of stuff at Christmas, you can forget about it, pal.
Well, I think you should ask Santa Claus to give Kohl's an interest-free loan for Christmas. What do you think about that?
That's a good one.
You know what? It might happen. I mean, Santa Claus, he does some pretty amazing things.
Brian, you know what? I know.
Know what?
The secret.
What secret?
Santa Claus. I've known for a long time. He's not real.
There really has to be something you want for Christmas.
Later, the girl begins to change her mind when she gets to know the department store's new Santa, a mysterious but kindly old man, played by Sir Richard Attenborough. And she'll believe he's really Santa if he can grant her biggest wish.
What's this?
That's what I want for Christmas. A house, a brother, and a dad. That's all I ever want. If you're really Santa Claus, you can get it for me. If you can't, you're just a nice man with a white beard like my mother says.
Well, Richard Attenborough is a nice man with a white beard, but he's also a wonderful Santa Claus, and he made me believe. You know, all the time, I get hundreds of letters from people who say, why don't they make movies like they used to? Sweet movies, sentimental movies, wholesome movies for the whole family. Well, they did with this remake of Miracle of 34th Street last year at holiday time, and nobody came. But now people can make up for it. This is a genuine holiday gift for the entire family, and people will be cheating themselves unless they go out and at least rent and probably buy this video, because this is even more fun to watch again and again than the original film.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's every bit as good as the original and more so. You know, you said it had you believing. That's the key to it. I got that feeling that I hadn't gotten since I saw the original as a child, that maybe there is some sort of spirit there personified by Santa Claus. And remember how he kept saying that Sir Richard Attenborough is a sure Oscar nominee?
Oh, yeah.
Had the film done even halfway decent business, he would have been a shoo-in. What a
shame. This also deals with more major issues. It's about innocence. It's about faith.
And family, too.
And John Hughes, who helped to write the screenplay and produced it, really updated it brilliantly for the 90s. It is a terrific film. I think it's going to become a Christmas classic
in this video incarnation.
Absolutely. As it deserves
to. Right.
And now to summarize all of the movies reviewed on this show. Our best bet is Les Miserables, despite the misleading and miserable title. This is a sprawling, sometimes spectacular epic with a few deeply touching sentimental moments. There are many scenes and many moments of dramatic and graphic violence. When it comes to gold diggers, well, we agree that this movie offers only fool's gold. It's a big disappointment, with terrible acting, cheesy special effects, and a violent, disturbing subplot that makes it totally unsuitable for the small kids who seem to be the intended audience. On Copycat, we split. Jeffrey thought it was smart, well-acted thriller that scared him out of his wits, but I disliked the stilted script and the overly familiar plot elements that made the movie itself feel like a copycat. It does include an abundance of tough language, some very twisted, brutal sex scenes, and lots of gory violence. We also disagreed on Home for the Holidays. Jeffrey hated it because of its obnoxious, talky characters and their endless, dysfunctional Thanksgiving dinner. But I thought that director Jodie Foster did an amazing job of making these people real and ultimately very endearing, despite their flaws and idiosyncrasies. The movie's rated PG-13 for some harsh language and a number of fairly graphic sexual references. And our family find is the new release on video of Miracle on 34th Street, one of the few Hollywood remakes of recent years that can actually stand up to the original film, with splendid performances here by Sir Richard Attenborough and little Mara Wilson. This terrific movie is a real holiday gift for the whole family. And my two daughters, by the way, age 6 and 8, both include it near the top of their list of all-time favorites.
So that's it for this week's show. Please join us next time, won't you, when we review Carrington with Emma Thompson in a haunting true story about tangled love affairs among some famous writers and artists. And Ace Ventura, When Nature Calls. That features, you know, the new adventures of the intrepid pet detective, played by, of course, Jim Carrey, plus other big releases for the holiday season. I'm Jeffrey Lyons.
And I'm Michael Medved. Until next time on Sneak Previews, don't forget to save us the aisle seats.
All the world's a stage, and you've got the best seat in the house with Channel 36. Top journalists from our nation's capital offer in-depth analysis of major news events on Washington Week in Review.